My most popular video of 2017, without a doubt, was my $70 Hackintosh build. It was a computer that I hacked together using used parts that I had acquired from a university inventory surplus and various Craigslist ads. If you're on a budget, you'll always get more bang for your buck if you buy used. However, a common complaint of my last video was that it wasn't easily replicable. So I'm back with the best new Hackintosh you can build using new parts for less than $350. Now, with this price constraint, especially given the ludicrous component pricing in early 2018, I had to make some compromises in areas that I felt a word is important, like the case and aesthetics. That may not be a jaw-dropping stunner like some of my past builds, but it's the most power you'll find at this price point that manages to hang with Apple's current lineup. Yeah, for $350. This video is sponsored by iFixit and their incredible ProTech Toolkit, a necessity for anyone wanting to build a PC. Get yours through the link below. If you're interested in this build for yourself, parts and instructions are available through the link below. And yes, prices on PC parts fluctuate frequently, especially in this market. So if you can't match the price of a part that I've used in this build, you can swap it out with something else, and I'll provide a few alternate suggestions as well. Now, for our motherboard, I went cheap, the Gigabyte GA-H110 Micro ATX. Now, this board is great for hackintoshing, and it will do pretty much everything we need to do, but it is really, really bare bones. There's no Wi-Fi, no Bluetooth, no M.2 slot, no USB-C. Again, bare bones. But it's also less than $50, so it's kind of unfair to complain about. The foundation of this build is Intel's Kaby Lake i3-7100. Now, generally, I don't recommend using the i3 line because they're dual-core processors and they're usually crushed in multi-core performance by Intel's i5 lineup. And then the i3s usually only offer marginally better performance than the much cheaper Pentium series. Alas, the i3-7100 is one of the few exceptions. It's one of the better performers in i3 history, and it will be perfect in a Hackintosh. And for about $100, it's a pretty fair price. RAM is a complete ripoff right now. Thanks to supply shortages and alleged price fixing by suppliers in China, it just is. So we're only going to use 8 gigabytes of DDR4 memory, and even that costs $85. Oh, wow. So that leaves just $110 for our storage, power supply, and case. Uh-oh. Luckily, we got it figured out. For the PSU, I selected a fully modular 520-watt Seasonic Bronze, which I know is super overkill, but it was only $34.99 with a mail-in rebate from Newegg. And that price is no longer available for this specific power supply, but really great power supplies go on rebate and discount all the time, and I've listed a few of those in the parts list below. Now, hard drives are miserable as boot volumes, in my opinion, so I chose a 120 gigabyte Kingston SSD instead. Now, it's pretty small storage capacity, and it's not going to win any awards, but it's only $50. If you can pay a few dollars more to get a higher capacity one, I would recommend it. Lastly, the case, a Rosewill Ranger M. This case was $17. $17! The craziest thing is that it isn't even that crappy. The sheet metal is solid. There aren't any sharp edges that you'll cut yourself on, except for maybe those breakaway PCIe slot brackets. But even then, it comes with two fans, and one of them is a futuristic, look how hip and awesome I am, non-RGB, just B blue LED. Where's the GPU, you might ask? Well, there isn't one. Part of the reason is because GPUs are insanely expensive right now, but also because macOS handles really well on internal Intel graphics, and so I didn't feel the need to increase the price of the build in order to implement one. But you really should spend an extra $30 to $50 to get an older, used GPU on Craigslist or eBay, like a 750 Ti, if you're going to need accelerated graphics or you're going to attempt some light gaming. But it's not a break or make situation in this build, so I didn't use one. And that's it. It actually doesn't look half bad. All right, enough gawking, because it doesn't look that great. Time to load up macOS. Thankfully, this process is a breeze, and it could even be handled without issue for a first-time builder. Again, instructions are below, but everything works, including internal graphics, Ethernet, and with a little modification, iMessage and the App Store. So great, it boots, it runs macOS, and it looks super, super dank. But how well does it run? Actually, shockingly good. In Geekbench, it shines in single-core performance, hanging with even the best of current-gen iMac, while it actually outbenches and performs every MacBook Pro, which is maybe a little unsurprising, but it absolutely plummets the current-gen and the last very outdated Mac Mini, which Apple has the audacity to continue selling in 2018 for $1,000. Multi-core results, however, is where the dual-core i3 starts to show its, well, its dual-core-ness. It shames the similarly dual-core crap Mac Mini and nears the performance of the base model dual-core i5 iMac, but it gets wrecked by pretty much everything else. Does that really matter, though? What's the real-world performance like? Honestly, for 95% of people, it's pretty excellent. It can handle multitasking, 4K video playback, normal stuff, like everything you would normally do on a computer, just fine. Even surprisingly, in Final Cut Pro 10, it works really well. I was able to edit 4 full-K Canon 5D Mark IV footage with color adjustment layers, and it experienced very minimal frame dropping. Not shabby. As for actual export time, though, well, it's not winning any awards, falling pretty far behind modern workstations. Again, this is a dual-core i3. But that said, it's pretty amazing that a computer that costs the same as 150 McDoubles can fare so well. Now, while this $350 machine certainly serves its purpose, it only benched a little bit better than the $70 Hackintosh that I built last year. Generally speaking, in this price range, try to find something used because your money will go a lot further, save old tech from landfills, and it will also exercise your right to repair, which is exactly why you need a Pro Tech Toolkit from iFixit. Now, before you click away, I know that tools aren't the most exciting thing in the world, but seriously, I use the Pro Tech Toolkit almost every day. Heck, I even bought a second one with my own money to keep at home. The 64-bit screwdriver set has just about every crazy bit size you'll ever need, including Apple's Pentalobe and Nintendo's TriPoint security screws. You'll get high-quality tweezers and some lifesaver tools to help you get into the tightest of spaces. Now, for $60, this kit is a steal, in my opinion, and with a lifetime warranty, you'd be a fool to miss out. Go to ifixit.com/snazzylabs or visit the link below to get yours. If you enjoyed this video, please give it a like. If you didn't, well, that other button seems to work okay too. Check out our other awesome videos over here, but most importantly, and as always, stay snazzy. See you later, folks. Okay, that's good.